So the increased awareness of ethical responsibilities towards the communities, where the documentary linguists work, where languages are endangered, has taken the importance of providing access to linguistic materials, not only to the international academic community, but also to members of the language communities themselves. So a local archiving institution, like local library, a museum, can start playing quite a vital role in ensuring such access, both now and in the future, because it can potentially overcome certain technical language-based hurdles encountered by some language communities. Well, contemporary documentation and archiving is becoming primarily digital, but digital documentation has to be more than a data repository. It has to find ways to preserve diverse materials and disseminate or publish them to a variety of stakeholders. With this in mind, the term archiving not only refers to preservation of language materials, but also to highlight the process of accessing them. And then I think if this is where the mission of archiving meets the mission of exhibiting.
The Pauline Museum of the History of Polish Jews in Warsaw tries to communicate the historical diversity of Poland with its interplay of different ethnic groups and institutional actors by using multilingual first-person narration from primary sources in original languages. Here one is guided through a complex history, not only not with a meta-level all-knowing museum voice of later historians, but by quotations from historical documents of individuals living at the time, speaking initially in Hebrew and Aramaic, Old Czech and Latin, and later Polish, Yiddish, Ukrainian, Russian, and other languages where appropriate in their historical fonts. To be honest, and I think the curators would agree, the result can be aesthetically overwhelming, but the goal is an important intervention regarding who speaks for the nation. A final example of language use that displays plurality, vulnerability, politics, and processes of change in museums' presentations of knowledge comes from the ESMA former torture center in Buenos Aires. Here we see how a panel of interpretive text has been copy edited with the edits intentionally left visible to take into consideration women's experiences of torture. This editing does multiple things. It expands visitors' imaginations to include women's experiences. It highlights the ways that gendered language typically excludes such experiences. And it also points to the museum's own prior acceptance of this exclusion. So it's self-critical in that way, showing how it was written in prior and showing now how it's been changed. So this is a great example of the ways that language use in museums can not only change the scope of knowledge that is being offered, but it can also retrain audiences into becoming what anthropologist Margaret Lindauer distinguishes as critical rather than ideal museum visitors. Those who no longer unquestionably accept the role that the museum language traditionally casts for them, and instead encouraging them to take a skeptical stance regarding what they see on museum walls and understanding their role, the role of the visitor, as one of critical inquiry in relation to what is presented to them in the museum.
Karina Lamb found in her research that increasingly in content management systems, collection management systems, documentation catalogs, museum professionals in Australia and New Zealand are collecting words as well as objects. They're collecting the words and the language associated with the artifact to add layers of meaning to it and to give more sense of the meaning and the use of that object in its original cultural context. Not just in the collection management systems, though, but in other ways, Indigenous languages are being used to reshape, recall, revise, and indigenize these practices of collection, care, documentation, handling, and so on. Here, Lisa Ward refers to herself, she's referred to as a kaitiaki. So she's not a collection manager, she's a kaitiaki. And kaitiaki in Māori means a steward, a carer, someone who looks after things. So a Māori word is used to refer to her role. Everybody that she works with back of house refers to these objects you can see in the collection store as taonga. So there's a preference to use Māori words for objects in general and specifically, rather than the English words which used to be in the museum documentation by Pākehā or European professionals. The object that she's holding is a tauihu, which is the prow, the model prow of a waka or a canoe. So increasingly, these Māori words are used in the documentation, as I can show you on collections online. The collection store itself is referred to as Te Ahuru Mōwai. So often titles and words and names are also used in preference to English words to assert the Māori sovereignty or perspective on these things and the ways in which they're done.
So from that section, we then go into this last building that I showed you called the Way of the San. And this really is where we want to change people's mindsets. It's a building that deals with traditional San contexts and those San who are still living in hunter-gatherer ways, where we try and untangle ways of these translational processes. We try and address the problems of translation. So inside the building, we use 99% San quotes that are used in different languages taken from the San. And we introduce people to the idea that you're going into a different space by this big writing on top of the glass. It says, and I won't pretend I'm probably pronouncing this terribly well, but it's something along the lines of Yale I oa no I mui a ka I sua kaore ngla e ka tonga, which means ancestors protect us and give us luck on our hunt. So you're going into the building and all of a sudden you're into this hunting environment. You've got to think differently as a hunter. And really the aim in here is to, as I pulled a quote from our Kwatu book, the task is to untangle things just enough, but no more, so that visitors could follow a familiar run of ideas, but also recognize the significance of connection. And the idea is that you come into this building and there's a soundscape going that immerses you in a Kalahari hunter-gathering environment. And then we gather things together in ways that the San gather them together. Rather than dealing with sections on hunting, healing, medicine, we mix it together in the way the San do. And we do this by using themes of special things like the eland, which is a special animal, or honey, which is hidden inside the rocks, or sounds of birds that come out from the rafters, special birds that tell you about the hunt you're about to undertake. Then we have pedestals that talk. It will be a quote from a San person from a different group. The quote will be in English, there'll be diverse quotes that link the information together. And then on the wall, we throw together ideas in this sort of word cloud fashion again. So on this demonstration of the wall at the back, you see the words kaho, which is our land as God gave it to us, and the words num and so, which are about energy. And the other words on the wall are about ancestors and wind and relationships and connecting how people live and work together. So word clouds are a way of getting across to people how ideas sit together. And another context in which we use word clouds is in these glass cabinets that you can see. So on these ones they are English words with the odd San word thrown in as well, because really we're trying to get across the ideas, the way the ideas sit together here, rather than complicate things too much with different language groups at the same time. But we throw it in to remind people that these are indigenous concepts. So these are printed on the glass. They're actually relating to these sorts of ideas. So women relate to water, to softness, to wide paths, tortoise shells, to the snake, the python, men to hunting, trance, healing, narrow paths. Indigenous San languages are keen to our museum. They hold the story. So they hold the story of colonization. They tell us about a distinctive way of life linked to folklore and the concepts of the San. Really importantly, having these San languages in the museum also makes the San feel at home. So when they come here, they immediately recognize their language somewhere. And they say, yes, we are here. We are represented. at the same time carrying these different languages in the buildings demonstrates the diversity of the Sam. So we don't really give much information on languages. I'd love to give a lot more. The guides give a certain amount, and they give it a freshness by being able to talk the languages. But what we try and do with the language where we do represent it is flip people into another way of understanding, where ideas sit differently together, where this constant translation into English is recognized nakedly as a damaging transformational process where we lose something and we have to be very careful about what we're losing.
Now, I would like to talk about the issues of translation. My current work at Minbaku is curating the special exhibition Arte Popular, the Creative and Critical Power of Latin Americans. It is to be held from March 2023 to May 2023. We are going to exhibit about 400 works of Arte Popular from different parts of Latin America and the Caribbean. Then I must name the exhibition title both in English and Japanese. So my task is how to translate Arte Popular, a Spanish phrase, into Japanese and English. Possible translations might be Mingei or Mingeihin in Japanese and folk art in English. Then my question is, if Mingei and folk art are exactly the same as Arte Popular, if not, what are the differences? In 2019, when I curated a small exhibition of Mexican Arte Popular in Minpaku, I used Arte Popular in the exhibition title without translating it into Japanese. However, Arte Popular, a long word from Spanish, sounded unfamiliar to the museum visitors who speak only Japanese, and it may have been difficult to understand. Based on this reflection for the exhibition now in 2023, I'm going to use Minshu Geijitsu as the translation of Arte Popular. Minshu Geijitsu, written by four Chinese characters, means people's art. Minshu Geijitsu sounds longer than Mingei, but sounds similar. It has Min and Gei sound. However, its meaning is clearly different from Mingei as a popular craft, and Minshu Geijitsu is people's art, a kind of art. I hope visitors will not confuse Minshu Geijitsu and Mingei. I argue that the meaning of Spanish Arte Popular is theoretically far broader than that of English folk art. That's why I decided not to use folk art as an English translation of Arte Popular. I use Arte Popular in the exhibition title in English without translation. Minpaku promotes multilingualism in order to cultivate in Japanese public an awareness of and respect for the linguistic and cultural diversity of the world. But it is one thing to have multilingual explanations in an exhibit hall. It is another to have speakers of those languages understand each other's culture. So only a careful translation process can bridge the gap between different language communities. Translation is one of the most important things a curator should strive for in order to promote multilingualism in a museum.
These experiments that museums are making in Mexico, which are very important, don't get me wrong, I appreciate the symbolism of including now in the website or in an exhibition, etc. But I go back to the question about why, right? Is it about inclusivity or is it about a performance of inclusivity, right? And how to judge that? And the way of judging that is by engaging fully in the act of translation, which is so crucial and is so important, and it cannot just be based on calques, right? What is called linguistic calques, which is calques or calcas. Calcas in Spanish or calcs in English, right?
Calcos.
Calcos, yeah, in English, which is that you take one text in Spanish, say, and then you try to mimic the same structure, the same order of concepts, the same spatial distribution, or in this case, you know, a summary of the same text without considering the ways in which, rather than, and you know, this lends itself to the creation of neologisms, which is part of the dynamism of languages, don't get me wrong, but at the same time, the introduction of too many neologisms, especially in contexts where understanding and connecting with the exhibition is crucial, risks becoming an empty gesture. Yeah, this encourage language users, now in this case, now a language users, to disencourage them to continue engaging with this inclusion of the language, because they say, well, I've heard this from Maya speakers. They say, do you see the text in the museum? Yeah, it didn't make any sense. I don't even read it, right? And this is Maya speakers, literate Maya speakers, who, because they found such nonsensical the translations that are made and included in museums, they just refuse to engage with that. So rather than becoming an opportunity for pedagogy, a pedagogical tool to encourage language users to continue engaging with the language, it disencourages them. And I think that translation has to be taken more seriously and has to be a longer process of interpreting and then allowing language users, language speakers, to make the effort of using their own words to reflect, you know, what the text is trying to say, you know, in Spanish, English, German, or whatever of the other Indo-European languages.
And the technique that tends to be used in Australian museums is that when you go into the exhibition, you will have audio and video providing a presence for Aboriginal languages rather than written text. So here, for example, at the Australian Museum, you get a welcome with subtitles on the video to visitors in the exhibition. And you can see the child there looking at the display below, again, subtitled video. So language tends to be present, to be made visible in exhibits through audio and video rather than through written text. To finish today, what I'm going to do is show you a few examples of label text at Te Papa, the National Museum in Wellington, showing you how Māori is incorporated with English. So here's an object label. Rather than being strictly bilingual, Māori and English are woven together. The object tends to be referred to in the Māori language, but as in New Zealand English, where Māori words are commonly used, vocabulary and so on and so forth, the two languages are mixed together. So notice there that word whānau for family, muka for flax, and tokotoko instead of a orator's stick or staff. Throughout the museum, the bilingual language policy tends to be materialized in labels which have text side by side, depending on the display. So on the right there, you can see in that exhibit, the Māori text coming first, the English text written by different writers. But in many cases, what you have is labels like on the left, where Māori words and phrases are incorporated into a mostly English language text for the majority English speaking audience who do understand a few Māori words. So you can see there, for example, the word tamariki being used for children. Signage throughout the museum, whether it's the toilet or wayfinding, is also bilingual. And even here, you can see when objects are taken off display, some of this technical signage is also in Te Reo Māori and English. In many cases, what exhibition text does is act as a pedagogical tool for teaching the language, whether that's for non-Māori, for Pākehā who are learning the language, Europeans, or for the many schools and education groups that come in. So here on the right, you can see a typical example of a bilingual sort of display with various layers of text, using color and elements of design to highlight that text and attract readers to content, which is, you know, usually in graphic form, but may also be in digital labels. And on the left, you can see the use of audio for non-Māori speakers to translate particular words that are in labels incorporating Māori words.
One cannot enter the AGO's Indigenous and Canadian Gallery without encountering the large land acknowledgement, indicating the location of the AGO itself on traditional Anishinaabe territory, and the history of the treaty governing the relationship of Canada to local Indigenous peoples. Along with another large sign welcoming visitors to the Indigenous and Canadian Gallery, not only in English, but in Anishinaabemowin language alongside English, makes a powerful impression that shifts visitors' sense of who is the host and who is the visitor in this place.
Aquí me gustaría hablar también del Museo Mapuche de Cañete, como decía yo, se llama Ruka Kimun Taini Kulil, que significa la casa que resguarda nuestras raíces. Y si le das el siguiente, este nombre refleja, digamos, desde el idioma mapuche o mapumumun, no solamente refleja un cambio cosmético del museo, sino que también se propone como una manera diferente de mirar a las colecciones y demostrar que la herencia cultural o el patrimonio en este caso es mucho más que objetos que se ponen en exhibición dentro de una caja de cristal. Para ello se trata de efectivamente una herencia viva que se refleja en la comida, el idioma, la música, la práctica ritual, y que es parte de la vida cotidiana de las personas, ¿no? Y que en este sentido también cuestiona el posicionamiento convencional que visitantes a los museos asumen de simplemente mirar. Entonces hay una invitación a participar y a juzgar distintas versiones de la historia y también a involucrarse con la lengua mapuche como una ventana hacia entender las maneras distintas de concebir el mundo que tiene este pueblo. Tenemos que el Mapudungun, también están los paneles, desde luego, en tanto que texto, pero también como grabaciones de voz. Entonces el visitante puede leer y escuchar los paneles en Mapudungun, así como en español y en inglés. Aquí un acercamiento a uno de sus paneles contienen esta forma de interactividad. Pero también importante es el hecho de que en estos paneles se reflejan no solamente una versión de o una descripción de los objetos que se están exhibiendo en esta exposición, sino que hay varias interpretaciones que se presentan de manera simultánea o de manera alternativa respecto a objetos materiales, recursos culturales que están expuestos en el museo y que reflejan distintas maneras de entender y de usar estos artefactos de la vida cotidiana de manera que esto refleja la multiplicidad de voces también en la exposición. También esta multivocalidad en el Museo Mapuche se refleja en, por una parte, en los medios, en los instrumentos multimedia que se utilizan, en los textos de las exhibiciones, y esto incluye también las opiniones de los que no son mapuches dentro del museo. Entonces hay se reflejan múltiples versiones de la historia y del recorrido cultural de los pueblos mapuches y particularmente de esta región, de manera que esto abre el museo a promover una reflexión sobre la forma de ser mapuche, pero es una definición múltiple, es una definición que abraza distintas maneras de identificarse como persona mapuche en los procesos de reconstrucción y de representación, reinterpretación del pasado, en tanto que un proceso flexible y abierto.
Well, I would like to show you for very shortly another museum, which is actually called the Lithuanian Hearth. More precisely, it's the Hearth of Lithuanian Studies. It's a museum placed in the Institute of Lithuanian Language in Vilnius, Lithuania. And one of the most interesting parts of the museum is the so-called dialect karaoke. It's one of the most popular exhibits in the museum. Visitors can tell authentic stories in all local dialects of Lithuania. So it's what is a phenomenon from the European perspective. It's devoted not only to the national standard, which is a symbol of ethnic unity, but also to all those varieties which are to be preserved, are to be remembered, and well, they are recorded and can be emailed to the players. So Lithuanian dialects are example of very, very, very of quite a diversity in phonetic properties, syntactic construction, vocabulary. But the game allows the player to listen to recordings of unique dialectal texts that have been completed since, well, for 55 years, digitized and stored in the dialectal archive of the Institute. Well, Riga, Latvia, House of Languages and Museum of Languages. It's still a virtual idea because the foundation, the House of Languages, which is a foundation, aims at creating the first language museum in Latvia by 2030. So it is supposed to be a place where it would be possible to go in search of language secrets and discover change in language and change in languages and changes in relations between languages. What is very important in case of Latvia's past and presence, which is vividly marked by competing languages, Latvian, Russian, Latgalian, which is a part of our calling universe, Livonian, Baltic German, Low German, Polish, Yiddish, Belarusian, Estonian, Lithuanian. The museum is one of the ways in which they are implementing the mission of House of Languages, which is to promote positive social change by means of language. This is such an important idea in the country, which especially after the invasion of Ukraine, is facing again very strong language conflicts between the Latvian speaking population and the Russian speaking part of it, where our fellow Latgalians are really placed in the most fortunate place because they live in the region where mostly Russian is spoken, but they feel a part of the Latvian language universe, even if speaking a different language.
You may think that Minpaku adopts multilingualism as an ideal to serve international visitors. The reality, however, is different. Although English is a second language, not all explanatory panels in the exhibition halls are translated into English. Some of the explanatory panels have QR codes. Using an exhibition guide, a small device like a cell phone, visitors get translation in 8 languages. However, such panels are still very few in number. Please take a look at this. This is a small panel explaining the role of sugarcane in Latin America. You see a QR code here and QR code. And using this museum guide, you can get translation of these languages.
This is about the communication style that I've just talked about, and how we say things differs depending on the language. So we'll have Japanese and the English version, not finished yet, and then also Japanese sign language version. So with English version, for example, we can just select one scene where, what does it say? Oh, my boss told me to finish a lot of work by tomorrow. How do you tell that it's impossible? So some people may just straightly say it's impossible, or some people may say I'll try my best. Well, apparently there are some people who would say that it only takes 1 second, jokingly, or sorry for my lack of power, like that. So if you select one, I would probably say I'll try my best. Then one could say how other people responded. For example, maybe most of the Japanese people may say that I'll try my best, or and so on. So one could see how one response is different in depending on the language and then also the speaker. And then one could see the distribution of the visitors' responses to this question. Now, I showed you the English version, but of course we will have this in a Japanese sign language. We are preparing a Japanese sign language version. These are all dummy videos, so the content is different, but it will look something like this. The special exhibition, which is coming this autumn, actually is about language and languages, both spoken and then sign languages. And we didn't put sign languages in the title, because if we made it a sign language exhibit, then the tendency is that only those who are already interested in sign languages would come. But we wanted everyone to come, everyone who is interested in looking at language exhibit to come to see that sign languages are naturally exhibited as a part of it. So every single topic comes with examples of sign languages and spoken languages.
The key really is that you move into the reception as you come into the museum and you meet San people. So everyone working at Kwatu is from a San community, or from a local Afrikaans community whose ancestry is related to the San, but they will be speaking either Afrikaans or one of the San languages, probably Kwedam or Hong, perhaps Xiongwanzi, amongst some of the other languages. But this is critical really, because straight away people get a feeling for a thoroughly contemporary person in front of them speaking languages that they probably had no idea about. Still existing. So then from our reception area, you go into our First Peoples building, where we start. It's a combination of archaeology and origin story told by the San, where visitors start to learn about the San and where they come from. So in this building, we use stories to introduce language awareness. First of all, we do this with this large book that you can see here, which is, it's the only book that's a story written in Naro, a San language, and it's illustrated by San artists, and it's a beautiful big book, so it's a very tactile experience opening this book. So that's an introduction to San languages, and then behind them there's what we've called the story tree. So this is the tree here, and off the tree hang electrical cords leading to certain key significant, in fact, headphones. And you pick up the headphone, you stick it to your ear, and you hear a story. It's based on the idea that San sit under trees to tell stories in the heat of the day, but also they hang things in trees to take things up out of the sand. So you'll typically find pots, pans, weapons, all sorts of things up a tree to keep them free of sand. So people listen to the stories around the tree, and we use this as a way of introducing the idea of extinct languages, but also modern stories. So stories are a very contemporary thing, but languages have also disappeared. And I've just got a little example here of a language which was last fluently spoken. Well, this was recorded in 1936. So this was probably the last time this language was spoken. Then at the end of that same room, we have a video screen that you can see here. And on there, we have a very contemporary san person, so someone who's, in fact, someone who works at Kwatu who's off duty, telling us a very modern san story. And the idea is very much to break the mold that stories belong in the past and to reinforce the idea that languages are very current, multiple languages are still endangered, but a part of everyday life.
In Wilamowice, if you remember, I think this should be, and if the museum comes to being, it'll be organized around the folk costumes, because that's such an important part of their identity. And that's also the way, for example, our friends from Wilamowice try to teach children by start names of individual, like scarves, shawls, and all the parts. Over 800 parts of a female costume have their names. So it's a linguistic subsystem. You can illustrate everything. You can illustrate morphology, phonology. You can illustrate morphosyntax with just referring to folk costumes. Why? This is a very simple idea where I think museology, anthropology, tangible anthropology of tangible objects can very smoothly relate to linguistics as anthropology of intangible language part of community and human being, isn't it? That's my very basic thing, especially in case of individual museums, which are so important because they are expressions of tangible and intangible identity. People usually knew how to exhibit tangible objects, but and that's what I said at the beginning, the only idea of showing, of exhibiting language was to display books. Well, how many books can you see if you are not a specialist? Well, you are interested in the first one, second one, but when the third one, you just browse the pages, and when there are 300 books, you just skip them all. Oh, there's a nice picture here. So that's it. But this idea of showing this ethno-linguistic parts, which can include, like in the Museum of American Indians in Washington, this exhibition about different universes, which also has a linguistic component, but well, to my expectations, it's too scarce. I would like to know more about this linguistic, because you can perfectly illustrate agglutination, polysynthesis, without using the terms. You just show the universe and the way it is described in the culture. That's my idea.
Our colleagues from Japan, in the presentation that I did, it was a very conventional way of telling the story of languages, right? With this very schematic representations of distribution, the family of languages, how they move about. Yeah, and I think that while being conventional, they also have a value. But I agree with you completely, Tomasz, in the sense that that moment has passed, and we need to be creative when thinking about how to curate exhibitions that problematize languages, or that invite the public to reflect about languages in ways that don't necessarily throw words at them, right? So you walk inside the museum and you're thrown, a bunch of words on your face. Yeah.